Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Frank Alaniz, and I'm a consultant for business. What I do is I help business find niche individuals, in other words, individuals with high skills looking for unusual occupations. And then I volunteer a lot of times with 6 libraries regionally. And we conduct a ton of workshops together. And so today we're going to be talking about job search strategies. And I need to kind of let you know where I'm coming from. I don't like job boards. Actually, I do for resources, but I'm not very fond of using a job board for job search. And the reason is most job boards have what's called a learning algorithm. So AI, the new term. And this AI is there. And what they do is they ask you to fill out their application, their registration per se. Problem is if you fill it out incorrectly, then the job board is only to give you what it thinks you want, not what you're actually looking for in a lot of cases. Have you ever gone to a job board and done a job search and got weird jobs? Like I signed up for Indeed and I would always get landscaping jobs. And, you know, I'm too old to rake grass. I don't even rake my own grass. I have grandkids that do that for me. So here's the deal. What we're going to do today is we're going to talk about how to look for a job outside the typical job board strategy. I'm going to be giving you a lot of great information, and we're going to talk about a couple of tools that I use to help people find opportunities. All right. And then hopefully you'll be able to take advantage of them. Everything we're going to talk about is free. None of this information is proprietary. But the next time that we get together next month, April 13th, we're going to be looking at job application. So this is the preview to that as well. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. All right, and let me launch this. I need to minimize this. Yeah, drop this out of the way. Okay, so first of all, I'd like to thank Tiffany in the 6 Mile Regional Library District for having me come in. This is absolutely phenomenal of them, and it's given me the opportunity to meet a lot of great individuals. So again, we're going to be talking about job search techniques, and my name is Frank Alaniz, as I indicated, and yes, I am an all-around nice guy. Now, my name is Frank, so don't say, you know, Mr. Alaniz. If you have any questions, you can, if you're online, you can drop them in the chat box or you can hold them to the end. We will have the ability to have a conversation at the end. And if there's anybody in the room that has any questions, just kind of raise your hand and Tiffany will get, you know, pointed out to me, and then we'll just kind of go from there. So applying for a job is easy. Not really. And I love this little cartoon. We're looking for someone with the wisdom of a 50-year-old, the experience of a 40-year-old, and the drive of a 30-year-old, and the pay scale of a 20-year-old. And I really like this because it's true. I've talked to employer after employer, and an employer is just like any business. When you go to a high-end store, you expect to spend high-end prices. You go to a medium store, again, medium prices, and then the, you know, Dollar General, you're looking at Dollar General prices. Well, we have a lot of high-end employers that are wanting to pay Dollar General prices. So it's up to you. And what you have to understand is you are in the driver's seat, not necessarily the employer. So 10 common job search problems. Number one is you're not prepared to apply for a job. And I see this all the time. I've worked with thousands of individuals over the last 10 years. And the number one thing I ask them is, when was the last time you applied for a job? Well, this morning. well, it's 10 o'clock now in the morning. So you applied for a job before you got here? Oh yeah, I found it online and I immediately applied. Well, no. In my opinion, and just to let you know, a lot of this is my opinion, but I was wrong back in the 40s. And so far, I haven't been that wrong since then. But I believe it takes a minimum of 2 days to apply for a job. So if you have to be prepared in order to make this work. You lack a strong online presence. In other words, findability. All right. I work with people helping them get their LinkedIn profile. If you're a professional looking for a job online today, LinkedIn is where you need to be. If you're a blue collar worker or if you're an administrative worker, then same thing. Or retail, same thing. We have companies, their number one sourcing is either on a job board or via LinkedIn. But if your job board presence or your LinkedIn presence is not there, I can't find you. You don't network. The number one way to get a job has been and always will be networking. All right. I can't tell you how many times I've helped people find a job and it didn't come from a job board. It was connecting them to somebody who was already looking for them. So networking. You're not getting interviews. Typically, the reason you're not getting an interview is one of two things. One, you did not complete the application correctly. Or number two, you're not networking. You're getting interviews, but no offers. It's really simple. When you go for an interview, you have two choices. One, you can walk out with the job, or two, walk out without the job. You need to know your value when you go for an interview. And it's not how much money you want. It's how much your skills are worth to that organization. You don't know where to look. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I love Indeed, but I don't like them as a job board. Why? Because, again, did you complete the application correctly? You're competing with too many people. When you apply for a job online, it's simple. You're competing with, let's say on average, 300 other people who have just applied for the same job. And I don't care if you see on LinkedIn, it'll say 10 people have applied for this job. Well, that's 10 people who have applied through LinkedIn. That doesn't include Indeed, the company's website, other websites, you know, that they have posted that job on. It's just one. All right. You lack confidence. You know, when I first meet a lot of people, what I want to know is what they bring to the table. And then you have to sell me on you. A lot of people tell me, well, you know, I worked here and I worked there and I did this and I did that. And that's great. But what makes you think you're going to do that for my organization? I want to know what you bring to the table, and that's where your confidence comes in. Company is looking for an internal referral. All right. I'm going to tell you, we have companies all over the region that pay bonuses to their staff for a referral. So if I worked at, let's say, BJC, and I referred you, and you got the interview and the job, then I got a bonus, all right? And then after 6 months, if you were still with BJC, I could possibly get another bonus. And if you brought somebody in and made another referral, I'm getting another bonus. So it's a good idea. That networking can bring you closer to a job than you think. You're unaware of your strengths and weaknesses. So I met a gentleman not too long ago, and he told me, I work for this large company, and I work for this large company, and I work for this large company. And I looked at him and I said, I don't care. What can you do today? I don't care what you did 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. I want to know what your skills and talents are today. And again, that's your strengths and your weaknesses. I can tell you right now, I've worked for Anheuser-Busch. I've worked for Nestle. You know, I have worked for Boeing. Who cares? I don't. So when I sit down with an employer, it's really simple. I need to tell them what I can do today, not what I did with Anheuser-Busch 15 years ago, or Boeing 10 years ago, or Nestle 20 years ago. It's what I can do for you today. This is what your resume is up against. So 250 resumes are sent for a single job opening. And this was a zip job. We actually produced this about a year ago. So it's a little bit outdated, but I still think that it's good. 75% of the jobs that are submitted online are rejected by the ATS. Now, does that mean you were rejected for the job? No. What that means is your application, number one, did not parse correctly. Number two, did not rank high enough to move forward in the application process. Or more importantly, you submitted it in the wrong format, so it never made it to the recruiter. So of the 75% that were rejected, 25% were sent forward. Of the 250 applicants, only 4 to 6 will be called for an interview. And then one individual will be offered for the job. So out of 250 or one, that's what we end up with. So again, you need to understand there's a process, and that process is up to you to do this correctly. Now, before you apply, you need to answer these questions. Number one, are you prepared? Do you have a customized resume for the job you are applying for? Do I know somebody at the company? Again, number one way to get into a company is through an internal referral. Does not my resume contain the keywords based on the job posting? So I've written multiple online applications or applicant tracking systems in my career and worked on many, many more. So here's the thing. When you submit your resume, the application is going to screen it and it's going to look for words coming from the job posting. Okay, and if your resume doesn't contain the words, next. In other words, I'm going to look at the next resume. Are my social media profiles an extension of what I can do for this company? So much has gone over in the last 5 years on social media. A lot of things have changed. My recommendation is to lock down your social media accounts. So whether you're on Facebook, TikTok, Snap, Twitter, whatever it happens to be, lock it down. So the only people that are seeing what you're saying are your connections. All right. Do I know my value? And again, like I indicated earlier, this is not how much you want. This is what are my skills worth to this organization? And most importantly, how old is the job posting? We did a demonstration of Indeed in one of my workshops, and I typed in Indeed, and I typed in administrative assistant, and I set up a filter to show the oldest job first, and it was 600 days old. All right, so when you look at a job, first thing I do is how old is that job? Because if it's more than 30 days old and you have to apply online, that's 2 hours of your world that's for a job that's been out there for a long time. All right, so think about it. All right, I never apply for a job more than 5 days old. Now, that's just me, but you have to think about what's in your best interest. Number one question I get from people all the time. So what's the best day of the week to look for a job? Was it yesterday? What about today? How about tomorrow? I get this all the time. I never apply for a job on Friday or the weekends because the recruiters aren't there. Well, how do you know the recruiter's not there? When I was recruiting last year, I ran 24/7, 365. Why? Because that's where I recruited from. A majority of the people that I recruited were not in the St. Louis area. I had people in England. I had one person in Germany. I had one person who was on a submarine in the middle of somewhere, and I could only talk to him on weekends when the submarine came out of the water. Okay, so you never know. But the question should be, when should I apply? And the answer is today. Not when, but am I applying correctly? I can't tell you how many people have sat there for 2 hours, push submit, and in 10 minutes, they get that stupid little letter that says, I'm sorry, we've gone with another candidate. Or worse, you push submit and nothing happens. You don't even get the little letter that says, thank you very much. No one is ever going to call you. So data is your key to today's job search strategy. Are you doing this correctly? Keep in mind, many companies are tracking you when you submit that application through their applicant tracking system, through social media. Even though LinkedIn is not considered social media, I just lumped it in there, but Facebook, Twitter, Snap, TikTok, all kinds of things, plus internal feedback. I have a lot of companies that if you're connected with somebody in that organization, let's say on LinkedIn, the recruiter or the hiring manager may reach out to that individual and go, I see you're connected to Frank on LinkedIn. Can you tell me a little bit about Frank? And that's that internal feedback. Know your value. And again, not how much you want to get paid, but ask yourself these two questions. Number one, what are my unique skills and talents that I bring to the table? Today's skills. Okay, and what value can I add to my new company? So I had an organization that I was working with, and the employer, the CEO, basically said, Frank, we are looking for somebody with these talents. And what we want to do is we want to hire them, learn those talents, and then he smiled and he goes, steal those talents, in air quotes, for our organization. And I said, I get it. I understand. So you have to have a positive story around each of those traits. What I do is I take my five top skills that I'm bringing to the table and have a story, how I've used that skill and where I've used that skill, so that I can start a conversation with that employer about my value to that organization. It's all about words. So one of the things that I do is I scrape the web for jobs, and then my computer system will basically pull all of the words from those jobs. So this is a manager's a scrape. So what we have here is the number one skill is communication skills. Now, that's not verbal and written skills, because you can see the number two skill is writing. This is a team-based skill. Can you articulate your piece of the puzzle? Can you defend your piece of the puzzle? Can you present to the team your piece of the puzzle? So it's communication. Planning, problem-solving, organizational teamwork, collaboration. That's what this is. So what you have to understand is how to find the words in the job posting and then add those words to your resume so that the employer can find you. Applicant tracking systems. And again, next month, we are going to do hard and heavy on applicant tracking systems or ATS and your resume. ATSs are made to screen you out versus moving you forward. Now, I have recruiters all over the nation that say, Frank, that's not true. And it isn't per se. But if I set up my ATS, like most ATS systems are set up, I only want to see the top five people that match the job posting. I may review, not read, all of the other applications / resumes to see if anybody else stands out. But here's my first five candidates. Keywords. Application ATS systems are based on keywords. And again, you get those keywords from the job posting. I typically use the rule of three. For every keyword that I find on a job posting, I'm going to use it a minimum of three times on my resume. Once in my summary, once in my keyword section, and then once in at least once in either my experience or education. Number one rule with ATS systems, it's really simple. Read and follow all directions. Submit your documents correctly. When it says upload your resume, don't assume that they want it as a PDF. What you have to do is assume they want it in a readable format. Most applicants are eliminated within the first 10 minutes. And again, eliminated is a word that I use to highlight this sentence within the first 10 minutes. And the number one reason is because your resume did not meet the criteria of the job. All right. Resumes are rarely, if ever, read. When I first became a recruiter many years ago, I was running anywhere from 300 to 500 resumes a week, and I spent a majority of my time reading resumes. And then my HR manager came to me and said, Frank, you're doing all this wrong. What you need to do is determine if that resume contains the keywords that we're looking for or the skills that we're looking for. If it doesn't, next. You create three piles. One, I need to find out if this person is available. Two, I may track back to this person. And three, this person's not qualified for the job. And you have about 30 to 45 seconds per resume. All right. And I always put 10 to 20 seconds because I've got recruiter friends. I would hand them my resume and 10 seconds later, they're saying no or yes, or I need you to do this or I need you to do that. If you're a job changer and you're going from one job to the next, you have to quantify your new skills. I had an individual and he was a carpenter, but he was looking for a computer job. When I looked at his resume, all it said is carpentry, all over it, until you got all the way down to the education, and then it said he attended a computer programming class. Nope, you're a carpenter. So you have to convert that resume from what you did to what you're doing for me today. Old school resumes, and I see this all the time. Since COVID, resumes have changed a couple of times. For the good? Probably. For the bad? Yes, because now you have to update your resume to the latest style. And I tell this to everybody I talk to. Give me a reason to say no, and I will. So if I look at your resume and it doesn't contain the criteria, it's easy for me to say no because I don't have to do anything else. But if I say yes, now I have to justify you to the person above me. All right, the next person in the line. So it's real easy for me to say no. Of the 300 resumes that I look at or that I looked at for this last posting that I was working on, 298, I look at it, nope. I ended up with a couple of two or three resumes. All right. And it's that simple. Give me a reason to say no, and I will. How many of you are actually tracking your job searches? So this is a job application record, and I recommend that you track everything. put the job title, the company name, contact information, all of this wonderful information. Why? Because if I'm the recruiter and I pick up the phone and I call you and I say, hey, I'm Frank and I'm from LMNOP company, and you applied for one of my jobs, and you go, who is this again? Oh, Frank. From where? LMNOP. Oh, okay. And I know right then you have absolutely no clue what's going on. And if you don't have a clue what's going on now, what makes you think I'm going to think you're going to have a clue of what's going on if I hire you? All right. And that way, you have a better understanding of what's going on in your world. So let's talk a little bit about non-traditional jobs. I did a survey a couple of years back. We surveyed 600 job seekers, and I asked them, what I want you to do is to prioritize the top 10 companies that you want to work for. And it was really simple. Number one was Boeing. Number two was Anheuser-Busch. Number three was BJC. And I mean, you just go down the list of the top 500 companies in St. Louis, and there's the top 10 list. Well, what about all of these other opportunities? So the state of Missouri and the state of Illinois are currently hiring. And when you think about, oh, I don't want to be a state employee, why not? It's really simple. Say, I worked for the state of Missouri for more than 20 years. I'm retired. I get a monthly income from the state. And the best thing about it, it's non-taxable. All right. So all the money that they're paying me each month, which is a lot, I don't have to pay taxes on. Work Illinois, our state of Illinois, same thing. One good thing about working for the state of Illinois, they pay better than the state of Missouri. Federal jobs under USA Jobs. Now, federal jobs require a federal resume, which is a whole different style of resume. So you got to keep that in mind. If you submit a generic style resume and it's requiring a federal resume, it's not going anywhere. If you're just looking for a part-time job, a great place to look at is Snagajob. I have a lot of people that are working on a credential, and so they just need income. So we got them hooked up with Snagajob. They got a part-time job, and they put that part-time job as a stopgap job on their resume to show that they're still learning. They show that they have active skills. Looking at the Department of Veteran Affairs, whether you're in Illinois or Missouri, va.gov, they're hiring. As a matter of fact, they reached out to me about a position as a recruiter for them. No, I'm too old. And then Google Jobs. How many of you ever use Google to find a job? Hopefully everybody. But if not, I'm going to show you how to do that today. And then ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter is moving into the space where Indeed was about 10 years ago. All right. So if you haven't looked at ZipRecruiter, they have a lot of great opportunities as well. Google Jobs. Again, how many of you have actually seen Google Jobs? Now, again, what we're doing is we're talking about non-traditional job search strategy. I have people that get up every morning, and the first thing they do is they open up their laptop and grab a drink, a coffee, tea, whatever it happens to be. And the first thing they do is they go to Indeed, type in their login, type in the job they're looking for, and it's, let's say, administrative assistant. I did this one just the other day, and I had 332,000 jobs. Now, first of all, there's not 332,000 jobs in Illinois and Missouri for administrative professionals. So that kind of tends to lead me to believe that it's an error. And then you look at the first page, maybe the second page, and maybe the third page. No, you don't. You just look at the first couple of pages. But because you filled out their application or registration incorrectly, they're going to show you the same jobs over and over and over again. And then you get frustrated and go, these are the same jobs I saw yesterday or the day before. So nobody's hiring. Well, let's take you to a new level, Google Jobs. What I need you to do is you can do this on your phone, but keep in mind that if you're using Android or iOS, you're only getting 40% functionality. So you're not going to get everything. But if you do this from a laptop or desktop, you're going to get more results or better, not better results, but more information to control your results from. So you go to google.com and you get the Google search bar, type in your job title. Now, if it's two-word job title, in other words, like project manager, you need to quote it. Open quote, project, space, manager, close quote. Why? We want Google to consider that one word. If you were just to put project manager without the quotes, Google's going to look for every job with the word project in it and every word or every job with the word manager in it, and you're going to skew results. Then type in jobs. If you're signed into your Google account, Google will return results based on your current location. So if you're sitting at home, it's going to give you that location from there. If you're sitting at Panera 5 miles away, it's going to give you that location. And a lot of people say, well, Google doesn't know where I am. Yes, they do. Google will return links to the site where the job is posted. It's not going to show you the exact job, but it'll give you the link to that job. Now, it may not work with Indeed, which is fine because you can always go to Indeed and look and get the bad results, I mean, the okay results. All right. And if you want to expand your search, you can always add a location. So project manager jobs, St. Louis. And again, you're going to quote project manager and you're going to quote St. Louis because you want that one term. All right. Now, you can always put Creve Coeur, but Google is literal. It's only going to give you jobs in Creve Coeur. So if there's the perfect job that you really want in the whole wide world and it's in Brentwood, Google's not going to show it to you because you put Creve Coeur. But if you put St. Louis, it's going to give you the St. Louis metro area. It's going to give you the three counties in Illinois, Macoupin, Madison, and St. Clair. It's going to give you St. Louis City, St. Louis County, Jefferson County, Franklin County, and St. Charles County. All right. So keep that in mind if you're going to expand your location. And then once you add that, what you're going to do is you're going to drop down into see a blue line. And that's Google's navigation bar. On that navigation bar, you're going to have these categories: title, location, date posted, company type, employer. Set any filters you set sparingly. The less filters you have, the better results you're going to get. Remember, Google is literal. Now, one of the best filters that you can set is date posted. All right, it defaults to all. I recommend that you change date posted to the last 3 days. Now, or the past 3 days. Now, what that does is it gives you today as day zero and then the previous 3 days. All right. So you actually are getting 4 days of results. Versus if you say the past month, it's again literal. If today's April 15th, and it's going to give you back to March 16th. All right, so, but I only want the most current jobs, and that's what I recommend for you as well. So here's my navigation. I typed in jobs, and it just gave me a list. Now you can see here, my default date is the last 3 days. Oh, look, there's Starbucks. I love to work for Starbucks. Why? I don't know. I am a coffee fiend, and you could ask Tiffany. We talk about coffee all the time. Now, if you noticed, down at the bottom, it says 100 plus jobs. All right. Now, I have my filter set up from work from home, manufacturing. All right. You can set up these filters any way you want. So if you're interested in pretty much anything, just type in jobs near me. And then, so I'm in Hazelwood, Missouri. So that's what it defaulted to. And then here's my results. So here's the categories, the first of the filters. Now you can leave it to all, or you can go and select any one of these categories. Now you can always add categories, but if you're going to add a category, it has to be a category that Google will recognize. But if you look here, these are all the industry codes that Google will see. So if you're looking for a management job, IT, admin, accounting, protective services, whatever it happens to be. All right. And then the next category is a job title. Now, my recommendation is you leave this at all. Why? Because let's say my last job, my job title was Workforce Development Manager, Band 4, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so what makes me think that the companies that I'm looking for is going to call me that as well? You never know. All right, so let's say you did advertising and marketing. Leave the titles alone. Leave it at all. That way, Google will give you every job title, and then you can filter yourself, which is a whole lot easier to do. All right. The next thing we have is location. So here's my current location. And if I'm home, Google knows where you live. Don't think they don't, because they do. All right. So jobs near me in Hazelwood, location. And then you can set this mileage range. All right. So my recommendation is put it wherever you want. If you put 2 miles, again, literal. Put 15 miles, again, literal. All right. I put 15 because I don't want to go anywhere. I'm too old to work. All right. But 15 miles will get me to the library there. So I'm good with that. All right. So now the next thing that we're going to look at is date posted. All right. And again, past 3 days. Today is 0 day, and then 3 days previously. That way, I am getting the most recent jobs Google can find. All right. Next thing we're going to look at is job types. Do I want full-time, part-time, contractor, internship? And then actually, this is an old slide. I need to add a hybrid remote. Okay. And in-house. All right, so you can select what you're looking for. But again, my recommendation is if you set these filters, that's all Google's going to show you. So if you put that all you're interested in is remote remote opportunities, and there's a company that you want to work for, and they have a full-time opening, Google's not going to show it to you because you have remote all. So my recommendation is leave it at all. You decide what you want, and then you screen it. And then company type, what are you looking for? Consulting, security, wholesale, healthcare, whatever it happens to be. And again, the more filters, the less jobs you're going to see. All right. And let me give you an example. So I'm an IT developer. I'm a software developer. I can work in any one of those company types, any one of them. Okay. And so why would I limit myself to say, oh, I only want computer services? And, oh, look, personal and laundry services, they're looking for a database programmer, which that's what I do. Why can't I work there? Well, I'll never see that job. Why? Because I told Google I only want computer services. Again, you decide what works for you, but all is optional here as well. Optimal rather than optional. Now, once you do find that what you have is employer, so you can select a bunch of employers. Okay. Oh, there's Starbucks again. You decide, but again, keep in mind, if you put that you only want Starbucks and Ed Jones and Wash U, that's all Google's going to show you. My recommendation is to leave it all. All right. And then once you find this job, so there's my job. Actually, I worked for Yo many, many years ago. All right. I can go in and save that job. More importantly, if you see the last block highlighted in red, alerts. What I do is I set up an alert, and if Google finds me a job, an opportunity rather, every day I get in my email anywhere from 10 to 15 jobs. So while you're going and sitting down looking at this job board, Google's emailing me a list of jobs. All right. And now I have my filters pretty open. Well, actually, the only filter I have is close to me. So I have 60 miles and I have last 3 days. Those are the only two filters I have. All right. And I want to see everything. And then, but you decide what's going to work for you. And I have an alert and Google sends it to me every day. Now, one proviso. You have to look at those jobs, because if you stop looking for them after about 30 days or so, and you're not opening those emails, Google will stop sending them to you. All right. So just kind of keep that in mind. So software engineer, jobs near me. Again, we get a listing. And then you decide what you're looking for. All right, even though it says there's about 2 million jobs, I'm only looking at 60 miles from me. So I'm only going to see those jobs that are 60 miles, even though the results are 2 million jobs. All right. And not sure of a title of a search word, a search term, use a Boolean asterisk. I love doing this. So what I will do is I'm working with a high school student or I'm working with a college student. What I'll do is I'll go in and I'll type quote entry level asterisk job close quote. And what that's going to do is give me every job that only requires 12 months of experience or less. And what that does is eliminate a lot of noise for a lot of these young adults. All right. Or if you're looking, I'm not sure what I want, try typing again, quote, assistant, asterisk, job, close quote. And what that's going to do is give you those, again, not entry level, but the next level up type jobs from Google. And then you can also, again, set your filters around there. Okay. And then the next thing that we're going to look at is how many of you have ever used Google Maps to look for a job? All right, kind of a rhetorical question. So I use Google Maps all the time. Now, Google Maps is actually starting to incorporate their new AI called Bard into Google Maps. It's not there yet, but if you're a beta tester like me, you will see some of that integration. Now, there's a lot of AI things out there. So there's ChatGPT, there's Jasper. There's all of these wonderful things out there, but they're not very good at search. But Google Map has owned the search, and Google has owned the search realm forever. So don't discount them. What I love to do is go to Google Maps, type in jobs near me, and again, I'm signed into Google. And what it's going to do is it's going to give me all of the companies that are hiring close to me and all of the services that help people find jobs. Like here you see Missouri Job Center. And so there's a lot of opportunities. Now, this is going to be based on your Google job search, what you've been doing in Google already. And that's what these results, based on the new BARD. All right. The other thing that I like about this is this is going to give you a lot of community service and temporary or placement services. All right. So kind of keep that in mind. I need something today. I'm looking. I'm not sure where to go. Try a placement company. All right. That's how I got into Nestle. I went to HLU, showed them my stuff. We had a conversation. They said, we have a job at Nestle. Would you like to work there? Absolutely. I went to Nestle. Nestle hired me away from HLU. And I made a lot of great friends, and I had a lot of great company with Nestle. Networking, like we talked about earlier, the number one way to get a job has been and always will be networking. A lot of people go, well, I don't like to network. Well, guess what? You guys are networking today, coming to this workshop. Whether you're at the library or whether you're online, you're networking. First thing I need you to do is connect with family and friends. All right. Typically, when I come to do a workshop, what I do is as I'm driving down the road, I try and connect with all of the we are hiring signs down the road. And I can tell you between here and you, I bet you can see about 10 to 15, if not more, we are hiring. That's networking. Connect with current or previous coworkers. Connect with religious or community organizations. Gyms, coffee shops, markets, stores. Finally, Missouri or Illinois job services or job centers. All right. They have ins with a lot of companies you may not even be aware of. So think about that as you're networking. When I first started doing this job many, many years ago, I had an individual came to me because I was that guy that stood in the corner, you know, with a portfolio like this, waiting for somebody to come talk to me. So my mentor at the time, Dwayne, he came up to me and literally poked me right here and said, if you don't get out there and start talking and meeting people, you're not going to go anywhere in this business. So you decide, do you want to work or you want to stand here? And I force myself to get out there and do what I do today. All right. Number one way to get a job has been and always will be networking. Finding keywords. In today's world, keywords are going to be a success. So here's one system, TagCrowd. Now, this is not the end-all, be-all solution, but my recommendation is what you do is you copy the entire job posting from the very first word to the very last word, and then paste it into TagCrowd, and then visualize. And what it's going to do is it's going to give you keywords. The keywords that stand out, in other words, the ones that are bolded are the ones that have the most weight in that description. The larger words, okay, again, are keywords. The smaller words may or may not necessarily be keywords, okay? So you can now get an idea, again, not the end all be all solution, of how keywords work for you. Now, a lot of people go, do I have to rewrite my resume for every job that I'm applying for? No. But you have to customize your resume for every job that you apply for. I have a little over 2,000 versions of my resume. It's really simple. All right. In the last 10 years, I've sent out 100 resumes. I've had 100 interviews and I've had 100 job offers. Why? I'm doing it correctly. But you have to decide where you're at and what you want to be when you grow up. Focus on companies, not job boards. I tell people all the time, find the top 10 companies that you want to work for and figure out how they hire, not if they're hiring. Check for offline jobs. All right. I went by one of the largest companies in St. Louis, Boeing. All right. And why? Because they're down the street from me and I know the HR manager there. So I went by her office and right on the door, there's a big sign that says, we are hiring, and a QR code. So I scanned the QR code and there was 100 jobs right on their door. All right. Expand your network. I had a young lady that related a story to me. She was really quiet. And she said, I don't like to network. I don't like meeting people. I'm very, very shy. And I said, well, I understand that. And then one day she went to the gym. And she was on the exercise, stationary bike. And a gentleman came in and got on the bike next to her. And she said, well, good morning. And he said, good morning. And she goes, I'm unemployed and I'm looking for a job. And she said, the guy was a little bit taken aback. And he goes, oh, okay. What kind of work are you looking for? And she told him, and he goes, wait right here. And she said, what? He goes, please, just wait right here. And he went back to the locker room, grabbed his phone, came back out, and he was talking to somebody. And he said, this is my friend, Mike, or whoever it was. He's looking for somebody just like you with your skills. And he goes, please talk to him. And he talked. She interviewed. A week later, she started the job. Ultimate networking. Attend events. You're attending one today. Hopefully you're going to attend, if you haven't landed, our next online application workshop next month, okay? At the end of this month, on the 29th, the St. Louis Garden Club, Job Search Club, is having an event, okay? We already have 50 recruiters that are attending. And then we have 15 high-end speakers, including me. I don't think I am a high-end, but including me, are going to be talking about job search strategies. If you would like to know more, reach out to me, and I'll be glad to share the link with you. Confirm your job listings are active. And again, that's why I never look at a job more than 5 days old. All right. So if you look at that job and it was posted 70 days ago, is it worth your 2 hours to fill out that application? And then target the right jobs. There is no more spamming your resume to every employer in town. First of all, it may not even get through their email filters. Second of all, a majority of the larger employers don't read email or resumes and go, oh, you know what? We should talk to this person about this. Because the first thing they're going to do is say, you need to apply online. So just keep that in mind. All right. And if you're targeting the right jobs and your resumes talk about your skills and your attributes for those right jobs, then you're going to be on track for your next opportunity. Key industry trends in 2023. Of the top 20 industries in the St. Louis MSA or metro area, IT or tech is 13th. Healthcare is third. Customer service is second. And the number one industry we have in the metro area is transportation. So keep that in mind. Recruiting will become more automatic. And since the pandemic has landed, and hopefully we're through it as much as we can be, recruiting is going to be filtered. In other words, your resume has to match the standards. The keywords have to be in combination with the keywords that that employer is using. Clean up your social media. Most importantly, lock it down. If you're a professional, and even if you're not a professional, LinkedIn is more important than ever. All right, I'll tell you a little secret. If you apply for a job online, again, you may be one of 300 individuals. However, me as a recruiter, if I find you on LinkedIn or Dice or Indeed, although I don't think I've ever searched Indeed for individuals, let's just say LinkedIn, you now become one of 3 to 5 individuals I'm interested in versus one of 300. Do the math. Would you rather be one of 300 or one of 3 to 5? Larger companies take longer to interview and hire. This has always been problematic, and it's even problematic today. Even though you hear all the time, oh, we can't find quality. Notice I didn't say qualified, quality individuals. You know, I have an individual that's currently working. He's in his third interview with a company, and it's been a month. And all he's done is interviews. And so you got to figure out what's going for you. Online applications are the norm. Have they changed? Absolutely. Have they gotten better? Absolutely. If you know their secrets. And that's why we're going to have this conversation in April. So questions. I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing. Any questions? There we go.
George has a question.
You didn't understand it either.
Okay, I can't hear.
All right, so he wants to know if there's a booklet, so if you want to share your slides, your PowerPoints, so that they can have access to the information, because it was a lot and they don't want to miss out on any of it.
Absolutely. I'll share my slide deck with Tiffany and make sure that she has your contact information. We can get that information to you, okay?
I'm also recording this, and hopefully we can get it up on our website. I'll have to talk to Talon because I saved it to the laptop again instead of to the cloud.
Yeah.
So it's got to go through that extra step.
No.
Any
no.
other questions?
Any other questions?
All right. So how can you tell when you get emails if they're legitimate jobs or scams? So in his experience, he just assumed they were scams, but seeing stuff from Google and stuff coming in, he realizes that they're actually legitimate, like ZipRecruiter and Google stuff.
Now, so any email address can be spoofed, which means it can be faked. So if you get an email from Google and you then make that a priority email, so you star it, then every time you get an email from Google, it'll come in starred. All right. So then if I spoof Google's email and send you a Google email and it's not starred, you know that's not from Google. Okay, now that will work on an Android and an iOS device, but iOS is a little bit different than Android, but you can basically do the same thing. Okay. Any other questions?
Every time I have both those speakers on, I can't unmute, so he can't hear us, because otherwise we'll get feedback and you'll just hear a really loud squeal. So I'm muting, I'm going back and forth, muting the overhead so they can hear, but you can ask your question.
How do you take a percentage of your pay? Once I had a job through Kelly Services, and another girl in the same company had the exact same job, and she was getting 60% more pay than me because she was hired directly by the company instead of through the Kelly Services. So how do you know which of these companies are going to take your pay? I mean, you know, pay for that job.
So let me explain something to you. Nobody's taking your pay. If you go through a placement company, the company is actually charging, the placement company like Kelly is charging the company you worked for. And then what they do is they pay you out of that percentage that they got from the company. All right. So when I worked at Nestle and I worked with HLU, I was making $99 an hour. The guy next to me at Nestle, who was a full-time Nestle employee, was making $48 an hour. Now, keep in mind, Nestle was paying his benefits and blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. And HLU was just writing me a fabulously large check. Actually, writing my wife the check. I don't actually make any money. But that was what I negotiated with the company. So the company's not taking any money from you. It's the contract that Kelly or whatever placement company has with the company that you're going to work for. Now, keep in mind, I've done this multiple times. Why? Because I wanted to work for that company. And as soon as I got there, after about a week or 2 weeks, after I got settled in, what I would do is start networking with that company. So when I went to Nestle through HLU, I was there 30 days talking with the hiring manager, who goes, why aren't you working for me? And I go, well, because I'm working on this contract. And he goes, I'll take care of that. So they bought out my contract from Yo. And now I did lose a lot of money and I went down to about $60 an hour, but I got all kinds of benefits out of it. I got healthcare and retirement and blah, 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 blah. I think I would have rather kept the money, but you have to make this work for you. So don't discount them, because I can tell you right now, BJC, SSM, Nestle, Boeing, all these companies use placement services, all right, to get people to come in. And again, you may not necessarily be working at the same rate, but how long was that person working there? A year, a month, 10 years, 20 years? You know, when I left my last organization, I was there for 6 months. I was making $240 an hour. So you have to determine what your worth is, not how much you want, but how valuable your skills are. All right. So, and then the person that was working next to me was working full time for the company, and they were making $35 an hour. Okay. So yes, I understand your concerns and your dilemma, but take a look at everything, because if you get into that company and you start networking, there's a lot of internal jobs that are never posted. It's part of the hidden job market. Okay. Questions?
All right, you're unmuted now. Contract work. What yes. happens if something happens and you can't fulfill the contract? Then you get sued. What is that? How does that all go?
Well, it depends on the company. Like when I worked with, I went back to Nestle after I left AB. And when I went back, I signed a 5-year contract. And 6 months into the contract, Nestle came to me and said, "We're out of money. Here's $5,000. We're buying your contract. And what do you do?" So fulfilling the contract, you should be negotiating this process the whole time. You need to know where you're at in this contract. And if you stay in contact with your hiring company, in other words, let's say Kelly, and you stay in contact with your on-site supervisor, they should keep you well posted. If you can't fulfill the contract, then you need to be working with your hiring company and your on-site supervisor, because there might be other opportunities that you don't know about. Okay. Now, if you can't fulfill it and they let you go, then what you need to do is regroup, go back to your hiring company and go, "Okay, I'm not sure what went wrong here. Can you help me figure this out?" Because you always want to stay in good graces with all of these companies. Okay.
What if you have the contract with the company itself?
Yeah.
And
for some reason you can't fulfill it.
What
happens? You get sued.
I don't think they would.
Especially if it's a construction involved where a construction project is dependent on you getting your end of it done.
You're talking about the employer level where they're signing the contract and they would just have somebody else who would do the individual getting sued?
I was looking at a contract.
Well, again, this is going to be different between you and the company and the company and you and look at the contract. You know, we're making suppositions here that we don't have all the information on. Can I do this or can I do that? I understand that's neither here or there. I've only been laid off once, and that was with that little story I told you with Nestle, and all my time that I've worked. But I've worked with companies who lay off people all the time. I worked with a company last year who, in the middle of hiring, they started laying people off. And I went back to the company and I said, "Wait a minute, you're hiring, but you're laying people off?" And the guy goes, "Yeah, but we're done with those projects. We no longer need those people." Now, construction is completely different than a corporation, although it is a corporation. My, again, recommendation is to sit down with the organization and see what can be done. Anybody can sue anybody. It's just like I saw the other day, somebody is suing the wing company. What is it? I can't remember the name of the restaurant, because they say their wings, boneless chicken wings, are chicken nuggets. So they're suing them. So anybody can sue anybody for any reason. Okay. Any other questions?
We have a question over, what's your name again? Teresa.
Change,
The job search board?
Yeah, the job search board. So,
okay. Did you catch that or
do no.
you okay? So she's been out of the she's retired, has been out of the job market for 10 years. So even before COVID was a little bit behind on resume creation. And so wants to know more specifically why job boards are not good. And two, what else needs to be done in a resume to make it more applicable for post-COVID? Does that mean, yeah, what's changed?
So is your resume 10 years old?
Is your resume 10 years old? Okay. 10 years since you retired.
All right. So what you have is an older version of a resume. Doesn't mean that it's obsolete and that you can't use it, but what you have to do is update it. Why job boards aren't good, and I'm going to use Indeed as an example. Now, I've worked very closely with Indeed in the past. I've met with their programmers and I've met with a lot of their salespeople. Okay, so I don't want to say that this is a bad thing, but what I want to do is emphasize that Indeed goes to companies and says, use our services and pay us a fee, which is perfectly fine. But what they also do is scrape. In other words, they send out a robot to scrape for every job that they can find. Now, the only things they don't scrape from are educational institutions because typically they're behind a firewall, okay? And federal jobs, again, because they're behind a federal firewall, okay? But they pull jobs from everywhere. Now, if you've ever seen the ZipRecruiter ad to an employer, ZipRecruiter says, send us your job posting, and we will post that job on the top 100 social media sites. Now, which is great, congratulations, except when Indeed scrapes, that job is now listed 101 times on Indeed. Okay, that's my concern with these job boards. All right. The other thing is now that that job has been posted 101 times, I, the employer, hire somebody and take that job down today. Indeed, may not pull that job down for 3 or 4 days. Typically, not that long, but let's just say. And then not only do they have to pull the job board down, but they have to pull it down from all 100 other sites. And if those other sites haven't closed that job could theoretically stay out there for 600 days. All right, that's my problem with job boards. Whereas if you use this little Google hack, it's doing the exact same thing as a job board, except it's only showing you jobs that are recent, that have just been posted. Keep in mind, Google knows everything. And if you don't believe me, they do. Short story. I wrote an article several years ago on how to hack Google for jobs. About 2 weeks later, I'm sitting at the hospital. My wife's having surgery. My phone rings. I answered. I said, hello. And the guy said, hi, Frank. This is Google. And I'm like, what? And the guy goes, yeah, this is Robert. And I'm from Google. And I said, no. And he goes, wait, ding. And I look, there's his information. And he goes, you wrote an article that we really liked about how to hack jobs for Google. He goes, but it's a little outdated. We'd love to help you update that so you can repost it. And so we've been talking for about 30, 45 minutes. And I said, wait a minute. How the hell did you get my phone number? And he goes, we're Google. We know everything. And I'm like, what? He goes, hold on. Ding. And he sent me my Google profile. Name, address, telephone number, shoe size, not really, but you know what I mean, everything. And I'm like, how the hell did you get that? And he goes, we're Google. Okay. And this established a long and continued relationship with Google to this day. But what I learned from these conversations, not only with Indeed, within LinkedIn, I've worked very closely with LinkedIn, I've worked very closely with Google and multiple organizations and ATS software programs. And what I've learned is you have to have the right information at the right time to be successful. And so why apply for a job? When I was a recruiter, I'd launch my brand new job on Monday and I'd close that job out on Friday. So if you hadn't applied by Friday afternoon at 2 o'clock when I left for the day, I don't care. I'll never look at you because my job's closed. So I learned a long time ago, not every company's like this, but I can tell you right now, there's one very large company here in St. Louis that will post a job. When it gets 40 applicants, it closes the job. Okay? So being first in line is to your success. Having the right resume will make it even better. Now, I'm going to be doing a resume class here in the near future. So connect with me, connect with Tiffany, and we will make sure that we can help you get your resume on target. Okay? Questions?
Yes, we do have another question. George.
You mentioned about I have been on disability for 10 years. Doing part-time real estate that I don't feel I'm making enough from it. And I want to do something in as much as I can. Now, I'm thinking the only thing I can probably search and look for would be something like a property management or a customer service type of job. And how can I change my resume if I did the same thing for 31 years?
Okay, I didn't get any of that. Sorry,
George. Yeah, that's George. So background, he talked about how you change your resume by the job offering, but he has 31 years as a licensed real estate broker and 10 years on disability, and is concerned about updating his resume. He's concerned about what jobs to apply for as well, including what he thinks is property management and customer service is what he
That's
would be.
Yeah.
You're wondering what else?
Okay, so you've got 31 years as a real estate agent, right?
31 years as a real estate agent, yes.
And I don't care about the disability. The only thing I care about, I'm a disabled veteran. So the only thing I care about is, will that disability affect your job that I have to do a reasonable accommodation? So when you tell me about disability, that sets immediate a barrier to employment. So unless it's necessary that you have a reasonable accommodation, why bring it up? All right.
So
what do you want to be when you grow up? That's the question. It's not
what do you want to be when you grow up?
That you want to need to apply for. That's the easy part. So as a real estate agent, you've got customer service skills. Okay. You have people skills. You have communication skills. You have the ability to negotiate. You have the ability to do accounting, not like sit down accounting, but accounting to build that relationships. You have the ability for, again, building management. You have the ability to negotiate with vendors. So there's a lot of things that are available to you. You're only limited by you. When I look for a job, I'm looking for 8 different jobs, from a software developer to trainer to HR to blah, 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 blah. You have to figure out where you want to go. All right. I'm 111 years old. It's that simple. All right.
The last job
the last job that I applied for, literally, there was 5 other job offers on the table. Did I want them? No. Did I even want to apply for them? I did not apply for a single one of those jobs. People came to me and go, we've seen what you can do. Help us do what we need to be, help us be successful in our endeavors. That's where you want to be. What skills do you bring to the table? Not what you've done in the past. So I truly don't care that you worked at Anheuser-Busch. I don't care that you worked at Star Realty. I don't care that you are a customer service person at blah, 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 blah. What I want to know is, what can you do for my organization today? That's where you start your resume. Let me give you a good example. I'm going to share my screen real quick here. Let me see, is this the one? Experienced program developer, facilitator, and veteran with a demonstrative history of working in workforce development, skilled in community outreach, public speaking, career development, counseling, training, leadership. Strong educational background in information systems, personnel systems management. Winners of multiple awards for outstanding service, including 5 national awards and 2 State of Missouri awards. This is what I bring to the table. Are you telling me in your resume what you bring to the table? Yes or no? So when I'm marketing myself to an employer, what I'm going to do is this, real simple. I'm going to take the keywords from the job posting and I'm going to embed them in my resume. I'm not rewriting the resume, but I'm going to take words that don't need to be there and replace them with words that do. I'm going to have a story around each one of those words that I add. Right now, it takes me about 45 minutes from start to finish. That means when I open up my laptop to when I close my laptop to recreate another resume. And it's that simple. Now, are you there? No. Will you be there? Hopefully. Can we help you? Yes. Right there in the library where you're at, or whether you're online, they have tremendous programs that can assist you in resume development. My job is to guide you. First of all, I have a person that's paying me a lot of money to rebuild their resume. Most people can't afford it. Okay, but they can. And so my wife once something. She wants kitchen cabinets. So I said, well, this is how much it's going to cost. And they said, I'll pay it. So you decide. My job is not to write your resume. Why? Because during that interview, you can't turn around and go, hey, Frank, why did we put this in my resume? You have to be 100% vetted on in that resume design, in the content of that resume. Because as a recruiter, that's what I have in front of me that tells me about you. So if I see something on your resume and I go, you know, George, I see here that you worked for All Star Realty for 30 years. That's great. But I need somebody can do this. And it doesn't say that on your resume. Can you do this? In all actuality, George, I wouldn't talk to you unless it was on your resume. But let's just say it was. You need to tell me how that's going to work for me today. The easiest person to get a job is somebody that hasn't had a job for a while. So you're retired? Great. Okay, the other individual that's retired there too, great. But what you have to do is tell me what you've done in the last 10 years. And then we develop a resume strategy around that, and then take what you've done in the past to support that resume. Keep in mind, 14 years ago, there was no LinkedIn, there was no Facebook, there was no Twitter. Everything is online. So what is your digital footprint today? Questions?
I've got zilch. Okay. We're at 3 o'clock already. So if there's any last questions.
Yeah, ask about liabilities. If you can have an accident, it's your fault.
What happens? So concerned about liability while employed, if there's an accident and it's your fault.
Okay, that's going to be between you and your company, unfortunately. There's absolutely no way I can answer that question. So look at your contract and see what your contract says with that company. If it's your fault, the company has multiple resources. One, they can just terminate you. Two, they can, like, I can tell you, GM would send you to school so you would learn not to do it again. So it really, really depends on the company and that organization. So my recommendation is to read your contract.
I don't want a contract. Okay, what about how do you become a vendor without going through the whole process of becoming a vendor? How do you sell something? Say I want to sell t-shirts at their gift shop. How do I get them to let me bring in t-shirt, say on consignment type of thing, where I can just bring in a few. If those sell, I can take them and bring in a few more, you know.
This is a St. Louis Zoo that you've been applying.
Yeah. Okay, St. Louis Zoo is a city of St. Louis organization. They are owned and run by the city of St. Louis. So what you have to do is go to the city of St. Louis, the zoo. Now, I could be wrong, may not have that capability to say, yes, you can consign, because they do everything through the city itself. So what you would have to do is go to the zoo, talk to the management about becoming a vendor, and then chances are you're going to have to go through something with the city itself. Okay, and keep in mind that you're going to have to use their logos, their colors, their branding, because it's the city of St. Louis. So if you wanted to say, oh, my organization is Panda Flex, and so you have a picture of a panda and you've got Panda Flex logo, have you ever noticed every logo on there says St. Louis Zoo?
Yeah. Well,
yep.
Naturally, you'd use their name.
I know. The problem is you have to buy that logo from them or rent it.
Okay. That's why you don't see a lot of people doing that.
Yes.
Okay.
Because they're going to make money on that from every angle. They're going to want to sell you the shirts. They're going to want to sell you the the logo. They're gonna, and then actually they only license the logo for whatever period of time. So I worked for the city of St. Louis for 10 years and I had my own brand and my own logo, but I was working and no, you can't use any of that. You have to use our stuff.
Okay. Great questions, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you, Frank. Appreciate your time.
All right. You all have a good one. Thank you so much. If there's anything I can do, please reach out at any time.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yes, your email address.
It's going to be in my slide deck that I'm sending.
Okay.
So okay. You have an email, right? Just make sure you give me your email.
And... Yeah, but it's not secure. Okay. All this, it's flooded with one ads and from God knows who.
Thank you, Frank. I'm going to stop recording.
All right. Take